from John. Then Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "Well, we are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, you give us freedom through your death and resurrection. You free us from sin and death and the evil one. And so we pray this day your Holy Spirit will breathe in us your word once again, that we might experience anew the freedom that you give. Amen. Jesus uses the net of grace to catch us in his love, God's love. And so as followers of Jesus, we are on a mission going fishing, grace net fishing. So how do we describe a grace net, the grace Jesus uses to catch us and other people too? A grace net is like this, we might say. God knows everything there is to know about you and me, and God loves you and me. God loves us with no strings attached. That's grace. Grace alone was really the rallying cry of the Reformation back in the time of Martin Luther. Thank you to the young people for their skit telling us that story of Martin Luther 500 years ago now. And that reform movement centered on grace, God's undeserved, unmerited gift in Christ. It really transformed and changed the whole church. The movement was energized by an emphasis on God's word, especially a passage from the Bible like Ephesians 2. "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is a gift from God." We are saved by God's grace-filled love in Christ Jesus, who died for us and rose again. It's like a net that is put down into the water, into the depths of our lives, where no one else would go to find us, let alone to love us. Amazing grace goes down into our lives all the way. Jesus lowers himself completely into the brokenness out of love for us, all the way down to the murky stuff, our sin, even our death. Jesus comes to meet us where we are and to save us. Now, it took Martin Luther a number of years to come to this kind of grace-centered understanding of God's love for us in Christ. Martin was born in 1483. He was the second of four sons to Hans and Margaret Luther in a small north-central town in Germany, Eisleben. Martin grew up in a church home. In his childhood and youth, both church and society gave him a view of God that was a God of justice and wrath. Martin lived during the time of the Black Plague. People were dying. In fact, in Europe, 30 to 60% of the total population was lost to the Black Plague. And so it was in everyone's mind all the time. Am I next? Who is next? And Luther had this fear of God's judgment instilled in him from that young age. And life was severe at home too. He even had an occasion where he disobeyed his parents and, because of a beating that he got, ran away from home. In 1501, he entered the University of Erfurt, where he earned both a Bachelor and Master of Arts degrees. He then began teaching at Erfurt and also began to study law. But there was for Luther the constant nagging fear that he had not done enough for God, enough for God to be gracious to him, enough for God to love him. And so he had this lingering fear that God would not love him or accept him. Following a traumatic experience in a summer thunderstorm, Luther changed directions and vowed to become a monk. He would end his pursuit of becoming a lawyer and enter the monastic life, in his words, in order to obtain a merciful God by denying myself and doing good. And by all outward appearances, Luther succeeded very quickly in his new monastic life. Within a few years, he was made third in charge of his monastery, and 3 years later was appointed district vicar, which meant he had responsibility for 11 monasteries. This was at the age of 27 or 28. But for Luther, there was this question that kept nagging him. What if I am not good enough? Enough for God. Enough for God to be merciful. Enough for God to love me. We might think we are more sophisticated now than in the Middle Ages where Luther lived, but the world is still organized around you get what you deserve, you get what you pay for. We expect people to prove their worth. I visited recently with a friend I have known for almost 40 years. He and his wife live in another state hundreds of miles from here. They were on a trip this summer and stopped and stayed with us one night in our home. He told me something as they were visiting with us I hadn't heard him say before. It was a time in his life when he was 16 years old and his father and mother separated. This is the way he found out about it. He came home one day and found that the kitchen was empty. Everything from the kitchen was gone. His mother had moved and taken everything with her from the kitchen. He said he felt rejection. He felt no good. He had so much shame and anger, he said. He said he worked it out in football practice against the others on the team or in games, but the hurt and the pain did not go away. He had gotten what he deserved. That's the way it felt. At a point just before he graduated from high school, when he was hanging with the wrong crowd on the other side of the railroad tracks in his town, God's love found him. He said it was completely unexpected, and God's love came in the form of a friend who happened to also be from the Lutheran Church in town, who risked coming to the other side of the tracks. It changed his life. It was pure grace. Lewis Smedes describes the transformation God's grace brings in this way. Hard-nosed common sense will tell you that you are too wrong to meet the standards of a holy God. God's grace, however, tells you that it's all right in spite of so much of you that is all wrong. Realistic common sense tells you that you are too weak, too impossible, too failing to overcome it. But God's grace gives you power to send you on your way to being a new person. In this you get what you deserve world, God's grace comes down to us in Jesus and turns all the self-achievement shame upside down. It's not because we have achieved or proven our moral value that we're loved by God. It's because we are loved by God that we have value in the first place. Martin Luther came to see God and himself in this way at about the age of 30. He was studying the book of Romans and the righteousness of God. We heard this read as our second lesson today. There is no distinction since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are justified now by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Luther said in connection with his study of Romans, when I came to understand God's righteousness was a gift given in Jesus, if it was as if I entered paradise through wide open doors. My friend, whose life has been transformed by God's grace when he was young, has been visiting a couple of local bars lately, especially on Saturday nights before he goes to church on Sunday morning at the Lutheran church in his town. He wrote in an email last week, "This road of life has many twists and turns. When God seeks our dependence on him, he rocks our world where nothing else can fill the void. No person, no place, or thing can fill the gap. I have experienced God's acceptance and grace. I've been able to walk free of the to-do list to what can I do now? I'm going out tonight to have a beer with people my sister and brother-in-law call sinners, and their church has told them they shouldn't associate with. But weren't these the people Jesus went to? I feel that if you want someone to experience God's love, you may just have to walk in their direction instead of staying at a distance." Praise God that Jesus did not keep his distance from us, but came all the way down into our lives. Martin Luther wrote in later years, "The Christian faith is the utter submission to God's grace, which is purchased for us and granted to us by the blood of Christ. Consequently, there is no satisfaction for sins, no grace, no eternal life, except by faith alone in Christ, faith that Christ has given full satisfaction for our sins, won grace for us and saved us. Only then can we do good works freely to his honor and for the good of the neighbor, not in order to be acceptable to God and receive eternal life, but as a free response of love. Confidence in God's grace makes us glad and bold and happy in dealing with God and all people. Because of God's grace, we are ready and glad to do good to everyone, to serve everyone, to suffer everything out of love and praise to God." And so we are on a mission going fishing together here at Ezekiel out of love and praise to God who has shown us amazing grace in coming down into our lives in Jesus all the way down. I want to thank you for your free response of love, for the ways in which you love and serve God through our congregation. This week we are all being asked to pray about what God is calling us to plan to give in order that our Grace Net Fishing mission might move out through Ezekiel during the coming year. So I hope you will do so with gratitude for God's grace in Christ for you. And may God's unfailing grace and love in Christ continue to free you to love and to serve and to give with increasing joy. Amen.